I would like to welcome Ms. Sara Saeed. She has formally joined us for her session on skills development as a pro-poor policy. So currently affiliated with the National School of Public Policy, she was also an ex-civil servant, and that is all that I would say about her introduction. The rest, she will follow up. Ms. Sara, usually we introduce our fellows as well, very comprehensively. You're addressing a cohort of extremely diverse and fellows in terms of disciplinary diversity. So I do mention we have economists, we have architects, medical students, environmental science ke students, political science ke students across ages and educational levels. So you have undergrads, fresh grads, PhDs. And then there is a lot of geographical diversity. Currently, we are sitting across different cities and small towns of Pakistan and eagerly waiting for you to begin your session. So once again, welcome to the fellowship.
Thank you very much. I hope I can be heard loud and clear.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, first of all, to Learners Republic, Naveed Iftikhar, Fatma, and the rest of your team for inviting me to share my thoughts with you. And a little bit of correction that I'm still a civil servant. I am on the faculty of the National School of Public Policy at Lahore. And by education, I'm an economist. I hold two master's degrees in economics, one from Punjab University and the other from Oxford University. But then thereafter, I've been involved with different projects, different departments, where I have tried to use my background of economics and tried to create problems also. So I see that a lot of people are snuggled up and are comfortable. So I believe you've had a long evening. I won't be very long. I'll try to make it short, but you know, feel free to snuggle up even more. I have a heater with me, and I think it's a cold January night. And let's be a little informal. I will take questions along the way, so you can raise your hands. And if I'm not too detracted, and if it's not taking too much time, then I'll try and answer your questions side by side. So I've also requested Fatma to prepare some polls, and I'll start sharing my presentation with you. And then, if possible, I'll request Fatima to run these three polls. So I would like to share my side of the story as an expert who was looking at a project started in 2010 in Punjab, where three trials took place. So I call it a tale of three trials. What happened, I'll narrate it as a story. I was engaged, associated with the project in the early days. And I left sometime after the second trial, but the third trial has recently concluded. And I know that some people are not very comfortable with the ideas of RCTs. There's a lot of political economy behind it, a lot of negative perception is also there, but that's another debate. But I would like to focus today on skills development. Jis tarah hum kehte hain, a lot of people who have been engaged with the skills policy and skills development are often found saying that it's better to teach someone to fish rather than giving somebody a fish. So it's all very well, a very attractive proposition. But let's see what your views are. Skills ko hum is tarah se define karte hain ke aap tailoring skills, aap jo hai, you can impart plumbing skills, you can teach somebody to be a motor mechanic, you can make somebody a draftsman. So not going into the academic stream of things, but making people learn how to do things with their hands, so that they're able to go out in the labor market or start their own business and therefore become useful and earning members of the society. So the first statement that I would like you to vote on is skills development is a preferred policy intervention for poverty alleviation. So let's see how many of you strongly agree, how many disagree, how many are neutral. Fatma, is your poll working?
Yes, I have launched the poll, so it's there.
So let's see. Skills development is the preferred policy option for poverty alleviation. Let's have a poll.
Excuse me, does this mean what should be the case or what is actually the case on the ground?
Is the preferred policy intervention means that you're planning something to do about poverty. You have a very poor area and you have a menu of options in front of you. And of those menu of options, for example, you might be thinking of microfinance, you might be thinking of giving them education, giving them health, but somebody comes along and says, no, let's teach them to fish. Let's give them skills. So.
Thank you.
So, can you all see the poll? It is in progress. I don't see any votes.
I did vote.
Fatma, I was able to see and voted.
Okay, so it will show once I end the poll. Great.
Fatma, 25 people out of 33 have voted.
Great.
Fatma, is it possible to see the result?
Yes, I am unable to see it right now. Once I end it, the graph will come probably. But if not, we have other co-hosts. So don't worry, I'll consolidate the data for you.
And if you want to end it, so let's have the second question then. Second question, Fatma.
Yes.
Skills leads to jobs. Okay, let's have here we have the results of the first one where I think majority agreed with the first proposition. And on the second one, skills leads to jobs. Let's have the second one.
The second one is here.
Excuse me again. Can we assume that skills in the second one means relevant skills?
Well, yes, perhaps. But, that assumption is not always there. But yes, relevant skills, you can say that.
Okay. Relevant meaning ones are the kind of skills that would get you jobs in the market that are needed in the industry.
Exactly.
Job creators. Okay. Thank you.
Exactly. But then also look at how the sentence is formulated. Skills lead to jobs. So that basically it means that once you have skills, you will be able to find a job where you can apply those skills. So Fatma, if you could end the poll, we can see the results.
Yes. Can you see the results? Okay.
Yes, so it's almost 36 and 36, 72% thinking that skills do lead to jobs.
Okay.
Thank you. Skills lead to entrepreneurship.
Here is the third poll. Yes.
लोगों का ख्याल होता है कि आपने प्लंबर बनाया तो प्लंबर जो है उसको जॉब ढूंढने की जरूरत नहीं है एंड ही कैन एक्चुअली सेट अप हिज शॉप एंड स्टार्ट अर्निंग राइट अवे सो स्किल्स लीड टू एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप जी कुड यू प्लीज एंड इट नाउ आई होप पीपल हैव या ओके सो अ स्लाइटली लोअर परसेंटेज स्ट्रांगली अग्रीज 38% agree, 26% either disagree or strongly disagree. Thank you, Fatma.
You're welcome.
Let's go to the fourth one. Skills programs are easy to implement and are scalable. If everybody has done it, so let's end it and see the results. Okay, disagree. They're not easy to implement, but still we've got people who are neutral. There are 14% who agree and 5% who strongly disagree. Thank you. The last is, skill development programs are good investments. Could you please end it? Okay, so 58% and 29%, even higher than the 72% in the first question, think that they are good investments. Thank you, Fatma. Now, we can move further. Skills is another name for vocational education and training. They are also known as technical and vocational education and skills. And at one point, they used to be very popular with the World Bank and the donors. In a knowledge society, it is thought that if you have to be competitive, you have to improve your productivity, you have to generate livelihoods. But, you know, from the 1960s onwards, the interest of donors has been fluctuating. The high point was in the Cold War time, when people looked at the technical vocational education training systems of Germany and that of Russia, USSR, and they thought that you know, these countries are progressing a lot, and they were able to accumulate a lot of capital and economic prowess because of their technical and vocational training education systems. So the World Bank donors, ADB, other bilateral donors invested heavily in the technical and vocational training sectors. In 1991, there was an influential paper of the World Bank, which said, hold on, let's look at the different kinds of returns that we've had from our vocational education and training projects, and let's see what has happened. And it basically reported that TVET or skills project had very little effectiveness with reference to the outcomes that were being targeted. So if you're familiar with the economics of education, there was also a very influential paper and work by George, I can't recall the name, George Sakropoulos or something, a Greek economist, who wrote about rates of return to education and said that primary education was the area in which developing countries had the highest private and public rates of return. So primary education should be the best area to invest in.
Mamna, and thereafter...
Ji?
Mamna...
Okay, so... in the 1980s, we saw a decline in the interest of technical and vocational education training projects. It went down till 2000s, when it has been revived again. And again, the donors started throwing in money in the skills development projects. In 2010, 8, 7, big projects were brought in Pakistan, some funded by the World Bank and others by donors like ADB as well as DFID. So in Punjab in 2008, government was thinking about poverty alleviation. And they were thinking that, they were seeing in fact that South Punjab was lagging far behind the center and Northern Punjab. So there was a lot of pressure on the government to spend on South Punjab, and a project on poverty alleviation was conceived. They selected 4 out of the 10 poorest districts of Punjab and said that they would invest there. When it came to skills development, there was other new instrument that was quite in vogue in those days, which was to set up a skills development fund. And the fund meant that it was to be independent, it was to have a board, and it was to procure training from training service providers on a competitive basis. And therefore, a company was formed in Section 42, which was another fashion in those days. Recently, it's gone down in popularity. But that fund was established in company mode, and it was called the Punjab Skills Development Fund. The idea was basically that there are two markets operating side by side. There's a market for skills, jahan pe jo demand hai that is emanating from employers who want skilled workers. And there are the individuals or families who are suppliers of the skills. But it was not as simple as that. Individuals cannot directly go to employers unless they are trained. So there was a market for skills training. And in that market, the demand was supposed to come from trainees who want to get trained in a certain skill, say in plumbing, in electrical skills. And the supply was supposed to come from training providers. But there was a very loose linkage between the trainees, the individuals, and the training providers because of the fact that there was little knowledge about training facilities. There was also low supply and low interest from the training provider's side. And also the trainees did not have the finances to go for practical training, which is in fact quite expensive. So this weak link between trainees, training providers, and employers for skilled workers was to be filled, and the gap was to be bridged through the Punjab Skills Development Fund, which was to provide stipends to trainees so that they demand a certain skill, and it was going to procure training services from training providers to train people or individuals who could not have otherwise access those trainings. And then after training a certain pool of people, they would provide them or supply them to the employers. So apparently a very attractive proposition for the government. Its objective was to enhance income and earnings of the poor and vulnerable households and women by augmenting human capital through vocational training. I just heard the last part of your lecture, which was by Zubair Saab. He was talking about human capital. So just wanted to say that when you come to the field of practice, a lot of things which appear to be quite simple prove to be quite difficult. And in this case, here was PSDF, which was asked to go to Southern Punjab. The four districts were Bahawalpur, Bahawalnagar, Lodhra, and Muzaffargarh. And they were said that they were asked to train 145,000 people who were to be poor and vulnerable. That's important. Ke kisi padhe likhon ko unhone train nahi karna tha, poor ko train karna tha with 40% women. So Punjab Skills Development Fund entered into an agreement through DFID, which was the donor, Department for International Development of UK. And they entered into a contract with Center for Research, Economic Research Pakistan to hold three surveys. And they were very huge surveys with the intention that, first of all, these surveys would provide where the demand is. And then they would do a baseline survey and finally do an impact assessment of what has happened, whether skills development was able to lift people out of poverty. Initially, the household survey was rolled out, and this was about 14,000 households who were surveyed. The surveyors went to them and asked them whether they had a demand to be trained in any particular skill. They had a list of skills with them. Do you want to be a plumber? Do you want to be a farm mechanic? Do you want to be an electrician? A draftsman. So a list of about 140 skills was shared with them, and they were asked about their preference to send at least one member for a training program. And 92% of the households not just said yes, they would send somebody to a training provider to be skilled in a certain vocational skill. They also nominated one, or in most cases, two of the members who would go to those training centers to get the training. So all was set. It looked like it was going to be a large scale project with a lot of interest in the population. And these households I must repeat, were poor and vulnerable households from southern Punjab. So what Punjab government was thinking about, that it could, you know, through a policy, through an intervention, lift thousands of people out of poverty, was appeared to be close to fruition. So what happened? I'll narrate now three experiments. The first experiment was held in the urban area, where a project called Skills for Employment was launched. And these skills were mostly related to the industrial sector. What happened was that when SFE, or Skills for Employment, was launched, a training voucher was given to the families which had expressed a willingness to send at least one or more household for training. So those 92% of the households, 100% of them were given a voucher. कि जी ये voucher है, आप ये training providers हैं, ये skills हैं, you'll get a stipend. Go to any one of these vouchers, to any one of these training institutes, get yourself enrolled and complete the training. So the expectation was that these people would go, get themselves enrolled, complete the training, and then join the labor force. What happened, unfortunately, was that only 47% selected a course. And out of those 47%, only 8% enrolled. And only 5% stayed enrolled. So here was a conundrum. 92% of the households were saying that they would send somebody to get training in a vocational skills, but when they were given a voucher, only 5 were, out of 100 stayed enrolled, got admission, selected the course, and were there in the class. The female situation was even worse. Out of 464 females who were given a voucher, only 200 or something selected a course, about 33 enrolled, and only 16 stayed enrolled. So the project was faced a setback, and they thought, you know, that they would not be able to get a sample large enough to do the impact evaluation. Not only that, but how would PSDF get 145,000 individuals to complete their trainings, and how on earth would they be able to get 40% of these 145,000 to be women? Now, a little bit of politics here. SERP was pushing for a new round of vouchers because they wanted to discover why this voucher had not been used, whereas the CEO of PSDF, Punjab Skills Development Fund, was facing a lot of pressure from the then CM Punjab, who wanted his targets. He was asking him about targets. The Department for International Development was being asked that, where are the poor? We want to see classes running where you have enrolled at least 50,000 people, because, you know, if you're going to complete your target of 145,000, your number should be close to 40 to 50. In any year. So where are those people? So there were two main concerns. Why skills programs in the past had excluded these two segments, which meant the poor and the vulnerable, as well as the women. And why did skills programs had an urban bias, which was very visible? These four districts were mainly rural districts. And on the menu of courses, you know, that they were offering, they saw, it was clearly seen that very few courses were from the rural sector. So the board, after a lot of, the board of Punjab Skills Development Fund, after a lot of arguments, you know, decided to give a go ahead to SERP to carry out the experiments. A woman member of the National Commission for Status of Women and a senior academician were, you know, the main supporters of this proposal. But there was a businessman in the PSDF board who kept on saying that, you know, you have taken this skills project to the four poorest districts of Punjab, which is the wrong selection. You know, you should go for those districts where there is industry rather than skilling people and expecting them to migrate to somewhere else where they could find jobs, you could should have gone first to the industrial sector, where you know you could have found people above metric or above who had you know certain education level, and those people should have been skilled. Why he was saying that? Because it was because the skills that were being offered had entry requirements, and the education levels of the poor was very, very low. So even plumbing, if you look at the entry requirement of the government of Punjab, you would find that it requires 8 years of basic schooling. Perhaps the only skill which requires primary level of schooling is the skill of bricklaying. For electrician, they required metric. For others, mostly it was 8 years, which meant middle pass. So that industrialist was very strong and vocal in saying that, you know, you could find people who were metric or above, but you should forget about the concern that they should be poor or vulnerable. But the donors were not willing to do that. So the board gave them a go ahead, and they said, okay, we would not give up the objective of training the poor and vulnerable, so you have to design a new scheme. The fund came up with a new scheme, Skills for Markets, basically looking at women and to see how they could be trained so that their income could be improved. When they looked at the target group of women, they found that more than 90% of those women had never attended school. So this was a big shock to them. And the team then decided to look at training providers jo na sirf unko skill sikhaye but unko jo hai wo basic literacy or numeracy ki bhi jo hai wo training de. And then they wanted these women to be trained in a skill for which market linkage support would be provided to them, and they would then be able to either find a job or sell their produce in the market. थोड़ी सी आई हैव अ डाइग्रेशन हियर. यहाँ पे एक कॉमन परसेप्शन ये पाया जाता है कि इफ यू टीच अ सर्टेन स्किल टू वुमेन, पढ़ी लिखी नहीं है, और यू स्टार्ट यू कैन यू नो यूज देयर एम्ब्रॉयडरी स्किल्स, और एम्ब्रॉयडरी करके वो कोई अपने दुपट्टों पे कोई एम्ब्रॉयडरी करती हैं और उसको फिर मार्केट में बेचेंगी, तो यू नो दे विल बी दैट विल बी देयर एस्केप आउट ऑफ पॉवर्टी. But when the PSDF team looked at this deeper, they found out that a woman who was spending 12 hours or more sitting in the corner of her house and doing a piece of embroidery, the net return that she got was rupees 100 in those days. Like in 2010, ek din 12 ghante ka ki embroidery gets her only 100 rupees. All the rest of the margin is taken by the middleman or the boutique owner, who then, you know, designs, finishes the product and places it in the market. Aur ye jo sare functions in between hai, starting from the design, the selection of the material, then transferring the design onto the fabric, then getting it embroidered, quality control, bringing it to the market in a certain number, giving it to sales agents and creating a market and then selling it, is all in the hands of somebody who's also taking major part of the profit. So us aurat ke liye, if you thinking that skills like embroidery would be her pathway out of poverty, was a pipe dream. So yahan pe phir ye hua ke board ne ye kaha ki ji aap evidence ikattha kare aur dekhe ki khawateen jo hain wo kis area mein hum unko skills de sakte hain jisse unki इनकम जो है वो बढ़े. सो द सेकेंड एक्सपेरिमेंट वॉज देन डिजाइंड. दिस सेकेंड एक्सपेरिमेंट, इंस्टेड ऑफ टीचिंग देम एम्ब्रॉयडरी, आप साउथ की बात करते हैं तो पीपल यूजली थिंक कि जी वहां तो बड़ी अच्छी कढ़ाइयां होती हैं, बट दे फाउंड आउट दैट वेमेन डिड नॉट वॉन्ट टू लर्न दिस स्किल. वेमेन वॉन्टेड टू लर्न टेलरिंग. Women wanted to learn tailoring because they found that they were closer to people who were demanding tailoring skills. They could provide services to people who were in their vicinity. They could stitch clothes for their own family and therefore create some savings for themselves. So a 4 months long tailoring course was designed with a built-in literacy and numeracy content. And there was also a market linkage content with it. And the market linkage content basically was that saleswomen were selected who were obviously more educated than the trainee women. They would share marketable designs with the women to be trained. They would provide them raw materials, quality control services, and they would sell them to buyers. The theory of change. What was the theory of change? Ke hoga kya? Kaise ye aurtein jo hain, wo gurbat se niklengi? Sabse pehle to ye ke it was thought that tailoring courses with additional inputs like core skills and market linkages would be offered to these women, these trainees or women would take up the course because you remember pehle ke case mein to wo unhone inkar hi kar diya, only 5% of people came to attend the courses. So the assumption was ke they would come to these courses if there is enough encouragement. They would complete the course, usse unki skills level improve hongi. And trainees see income earning potential, use these skills, yani wo kapde actually phir training completion ke baad kapde seena shuru karengi. And they will interact with the middlemen who will receive buyers from orders from buyers. And therefore, after selling their produce to people, you know, they would their incomes would increase. So khawateen ki bahut sari mushkilat thi, ye gaon mein baithi hui khawateen thi जिनके फाइनेंशियल कंस्ट्रेंट्स भी थे, लॉजिस्टिकल कंस्ट्रेंट्स भी थे, सोशल कंस्ट्रेंट्स भी थे. फाइनेंशियल कंस्ट्रेंट्स को ओवरकम करने के लिए, बिकॉज ऑब्वियसली इफ यू आर ब्रिंगिंग अ वुमन टू अ ट्रेनिंग सेंटर, शी वाज डूइंग समथिंग एल्स बिफोर दैट, सो यू हैव टू कॉम्पनसेट हर फॉर सम फॉर द लॉस ऑफ दैट फाइनेंशियल एक्टिविटी. सो अ स्टाइपेंड वाज गिवन टू ओवरकम लॉजिस्टिकल कंसर्न्स. ये सोचा गया कि जी फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम इनको शहर में बुलाने की बजाय पुट अप अ ट्रेनिंग सेंटर इन द विलेज और प्रोवाइड देम विद सम मींस ऑफ ट्रांसपोर्ट इफ दैट ट्रेनिंग सेंटर इज इन द नेबरिंग विलेज. और सोशल बैरियर्स को ओवरकम करने के लिए उस जो खातून थी उसके नेक्स्ट ऑफ किन को बताया गया कि जी अगर आपकी बेटी या बीवी या बहन जो है वो ये कोर्स करेगी तो there'll be income generating opportunities and you know your family which is currently poor might get out of poverty. So ye constraints the jinke around jo hai ye experiment jo hai wo kiya gaya design. Physical distance jo hai usko overcome karne ke liye transport bhi provide ki gayi ya within village jo hai wo training provide ki gayi. Where women had lack of information, there were meetings held with trainees to share information on the kind of training that they were going to get and also what kind of returns they were to expect. And then they were encouraged to visit the training center to find out ki wahan kya ho raha hai. Okay. For overcoming the social norms, like opposition from the family members, separate meetings were held with the men, male in the family, who were also invited to visit training centers and receive information. And then to overcome the financial constraint, different levels of stipends were offered as a motivation. So 1500 initial khawateen ko jo stipend diya gaya uske upar देखा गया कि 2000 देने से कोई सब्सटेंशियल फर्क पड़ता है, 2500 देने से फर्क पड़ता है या नहीं. सो दो तीन वेरिएशंस इसकी जो है वो की गई. सो इसका रिजल्ट ये हुआ कि व्हेन दे लुक्ड एट परसेंटेज एनरोलमेंट दे फाउंड आउट दैट द लोएस्ट एनरोलमेंट वाज इन केसेस वेयर वुमेन डिड नॉट हैव द ट्रेनिंग सेंटर विद इन देयर विलेज. वेयर दे हैड द ट्रेनिंग सेंटर इन देयर विलेज द एनरोलमेंट वाज क्लोज टू 50%. Where women were provided group transport, even though the training center was out of village, you know, there it was more than 20%. Community mobilization and trainee information did not seem to matter a lot. So a little above 10% was the effect of these encouragement or motivational steps that were taken. Conclusions that the team drew was that it was extremely challenging for rural women to access vocational training. A lot of donors would come and say, "Hum ye vocational training denge, isse khawateen jo hain wo poverty se nikal aayengi." So a lot of people try to become champions of poverty, but when it comes to rural women, it's very, very difficult and challenging for them to access training. Many of these challenges cannot be monetized. So even all of these women were getting stipends, but you know, if you place the training center outside of the village, you know, there were hardly any of the other motivational factors which could work and which could make them enroll in that training program. So they helped only modestly. The key was providing in-village training. And it actually meant that the model for training women in a poverty setting was to make training accessible for women by making a very important investment on looking at training providers who were so mobile that they could set up their centers in villages which were being targeted. What happened after the training? After this 4 months training, their incomes, their 3 months incomes only increased by ₹174%. And per annum, the increase was 697 per annum. So very, very modest result. They had better training skills. So if you remember the theory of change, aapne kaha tha ki aap auraton ko skills denge, to skills to unme aa gayi. Lekin income jo thi wo badi modest, badi. Non-economic outcomes jo the, women empowerment pe, civic engagement, happiness pe, there was no impact. Jahan pe ye sales agent khawateen ke saath munsilik ki gayi, so that component on its own led to ₹586 increase in 3 months earning and ₹2,346 increase in annual earning. So some ray of hope was there. And in the case of market linkage, because these women were outside influence, there were better returns on non-economic outcomes. And these women who were being trained in tailoring skills thought that, you know, it was acceptable to go out into the markets, and they were more mobile, they felt more economically empowered, and these effects persisted when measured 1.5 to 2.5 years post-training. But let's look at the cost benefit. Itna kaam karne ke baad, aapne khawateen ko tailoring bhi sikhai, aapne unko designs diye, aapne unko jo hai wo sikhaya ke aapne apni product market kaise karni hai, you appoint sales agents with them jinhone unko 10 mahine support kiya. So was it all worth it? When you look at the cost side, cost effectiveness pe agar dekhen to jo simple skills for market tha jisme market linkage element nahi tha, that cost ₹30,000 per trainee. And it meant that with these kinds of returns, it would take 43 years to recover the cost. Jo enhanced skills for market tha, jisme market linkage or sales women saath attached thi, it would still take 23 years to recover. So ye cost benefit analysis jo hai was in any setting where you have donors, even if it is a grant, when it goes to the government, they would say that this is unfeasible. This is something, kitne iske lambe arse pe returns aa rahe hain, khawateen are at the most earning ₹2,300 jo unka income mein effect pada, so basically not worth it. So again, a moment of disappointment for the Punjab Skills Development Fund team. They all sat together on the drawing table again and put their heads together, ki ji, what to do. Industry waha thi nahi, rural setup tha, industrial skills mein males jo hain wo aane ko tayar nahi hain, as skills for the first experiment where only 5% of the voucher holders came. When they focused on women, they found out that, you know, it was very, very difficult to connect women with markets, or jo product thi, for whatever reason, women probably didn't have enough time at hand, or the kind of skills that they wanted was not lucrative enough. So there was no way out of poverty for them if they were to continue with this strategy. So again, with this in mind, the third experiment was designed. The third experiment tried to look at the urban bias. और उन्होंने ये कहा कि skills के जो menu है उसमें देखें तो it's only urban related skills. You have electrician, you have all kinds of industrial skills. So rural skills तो कहीं पे है ही नहीं. So let's see, because you know most of these villages जहाँ पे हम ये change लाना चाह रहे हैं, they are their agriculture and livestock is their mainstay. So let's move towards agriculture. It was difficult to find training providers, but some of them were there, and they decided to move forward with the theory of Big Push, Rodin Rodenstein, an economist who thought that if you give a sustained big push in a leading sector of the economy, maybe you know the economy would be able to take off. So with this in mind, they decided to saturate quite a number of villages with skills related to agriculture and livestock development. They decided on 90 villages, और उसमें से 30 control villages थे. 30 जो थे वहां पे सिर्फ उन्होंने skills दी in livestock and agriculture, और जो 30 थे वहां पे उन्होंने ना सिर्फ स्किल्स दी, उसके साथ उन्होंने एग्रीकल्चरल और लाइवस्टॉक मेलास भी मुनक्कित किए, बेसिकली विद द अजम्पशन कि टू दैट फार्मर्स हैड फेस्ड अ कंस्ट्रेंट इन द मार्केट एंड दे वर नॉट एबल टू गेट कनेक्टेड विद विद इंफॉर्मेशन व्हिच इज अवेलेबल इन फंक्शनिंग मार्केट्स एंड दे आर नॉट गेटिंग इन टच विद द राइट काइंड ऑफ बायर्स. सो ये तीन तरह के सेट्स बना दिए गए, 30 कंट्रोल विलेजेस, 30 ओनली स्किल्स एंड 30 विद स्किल्स प्लस द फार्मर्स मेलास. ट्रेनिंग सिंक्रोनाइज की गई विद क्रॉप और प्रोडक्शन साइकिल से, एंड दे डिसाइडेड दैट दे वुड प्रोवाइड ट्रेनिंग्स इन व्हीट, व्हीट प्रोडक्शन, कॉटन प्रोडक्शन एंड मिल्क प्रोडक्शन, एज वेल एज इन इम्पोर्टेंट कॉम्प्लीमेंट्री स्किल्स. और उसमें ये था for example artificial inseminators for livestock, farm mechanics for the agriculture sector, farm managers. So main farming skills ke sath sath jo allied skills hain unki training bhi di gayi, so that there is no shortage of service providers in those villages, and you know the whole ecosystem of skills is able to work efficiently. Stipends diye gaye to trainees and village melas were organized. So the theory of change in this case was ke training providers jo hain they would offer training, Punjab Skills Development Fund would offer stipends to the trainees. Trainees jo hain wo in areas mein wheat production, cotton production or livestock mein trainings lenge aur wo training complete karenge. They would apply the knowledge jo unko training ke zariye mili, they would apply the knowledge which would lead to greater productivity, and they would take this produce using the market linkage of farmers melas and sell them to better buyers, and therefore they'll be able to get higher incomes. So ye this was the entire chain of causality which was being targeted, and therefore through these trainings it was thought that you know people would be lifted out of poverty. This initiative, the third experiment, was called Big Push for the Rural Economy. And what were the results? Results ye the ke in agriculture, cotton and wheat, and in livestock, these trainings resulted in increased production, which meant household ki total jo production thi in these areas that went up by 43, 41 and 17% respectively. Very good. There was a 100.6% increase in total agricultural livestock production value compared to the control villages. So jahan training di gayi wahan pe, compared to those villages where training was not given, there was a 100.6% increase in total agri livestock production value, because a household was not only engaged in farming, it was also engaged in livestock. So aise bhi the jo sirf livestock mein the ya sirf agriculture mein the, but then all these three types of households, they witnessed 100.6% increase in total production value. The cost benefit ratio was extremely beneficial. Against a cost of 17,901, the income increase annually was 96,322, which made the group very happy. But they also found out that the market linkage had no impact above that of training. And there was next year a sharp drop in some of the positive findings. So here's a table. Okay, in the outcomes, agar aap dekhein, to wheat production increased by 41%, but dropped sharply 1 year after the program to 17%. Cotton production 43%, but next year to 17%. Milk production 17, and then 1/3 of that to 6%. Achha, surprisingly, these all figures are coming from our production figures. They are not yield figures. Yield figures did increase by 6%, 13%, and 4.8%. But again, 1 year after that, those effects were also dissipated, except in the case of milk yields. And total value of output, though, had doubled in the first instance. After 1 year, there was no effect at all. Now, here comes the interesting part. If you remember, the assumption was that the training se knowledge increase hogi, and knowledge se wo apni farm practices improve karenge, jisse income badegi. But when they looked at the livestock best practice or knowledge ka unhone test liya, to they found out that immediately after the program, there was no significant change in knowledge of livestock best practices. And same was the case in agriculture. And then the only thing positive in 1 year after the program was the fact that the probability of household engagement in wheat and cotton had gone up in single digit figures. There was no effect of quality and availability of specialized service providers, and there was no effect at all of melas. So it's still a conundrum after three experiments and three quite expensive experiments that the route to income increase is not known. The theory of change which was applied, in this case, the slide that I earlier showed you, that training would lead to knowledge increase and then to income. You know, this was not the path taken because there was no effect seen in the knowledge. Perhaps some other alternative route was working to increase the total production, but not the yields. Perhaps I think it was, you know, leading to a lot of enthusiasm in the family, that a lot of additional family members were offering their services to the household, and therefore the total production went up, but the yield did not go up to a large extent. And because of those greater number of hands on the farm, the total production increased. So coming to our, you know, the design of skills development programs, when it is to be for poverty, when skills development is thought to be a magic pill for poverty alleviation, three questions have to be asked. Do the poor have access to skills? Do the trainings that have been selected, is it that they have certain educational requirements? Are they being offered at centers which are too far away from the trainees themselves? Do they have enough information about the kind of skills that they're going to receive? So if not, then the whole point of designing a skills development program on the assumption that poor would get those skills is basically not true. The second question is, what does it mean to acquire skills? What would these skills lead to? What does it mean to acquire skills? Are they meant to create jobs, or are they meant to lead to employment? Once skills are acquired, how do they lead to skills? How do they lead to jobs? Do people form their own businesses? Do they get to find new jobs? Do they get to improve the productivity of work that they are already doing? So how does it lead to jobs and income? So these three questions are very, very important whenever one is designing a skills development program, expecting to target poor and vulnerable. So here are the five questions or five statements that we saw, and we had a poll on it, on each one of them. Basically, skills development is the preferred policy option for poverty eradication if, you know, the demand for skills has no entry barriers. But as we saw that there are a number of entry barriers. A majority of poor target population has low educational attainment levels. Those of you who are familiar with some of the skills development history in Pakistan, there's a lot of criticism on our flagship cash transfer program, Benazir Income Support Program, and people say that it's probably not a good idea to give this free cash to women. They should actually be trained in something. Some years back, an experiment was done, and these women were offered vocational training skills, but unfortunately, you know, there could not be enough trainees who could meet the access requirements, either because of the logistical, social, or financial constraints, or because of the educational constraints. Because even to learn a skill like tailoring, you have to know the skills of literacy and numeracy, to take measurements, to record measurements, to do certain calculations and calculate angles. You need to have at least primary to middle level of educational attainment level. Skill supply has an urban and industrial bias. Most of the skills that are being offered by our training providers are suitable to the urban environment and to the industrial concerns. There is very little attention towards agriculture and rural areas. Skills leads to jobs. So this is a myth, because jobs will only be there if the economy is growing. So if the economy is in recession, you can't expect to skill people, give them vocational skills, and expect that they would find jobs themselves. A famous economist once said that skills follow jobs and not vice versa. So only if you have jobs in the economy, you should be scaling up your skills programs. Otherwise, you should concentrate giving people replacement skills. For example, in a shrinking economy, there will be people who will be kicked out of their jobs. So reskilling them should be your main concern in times of low growth. Skilled people do not end up automatically as employees or as self-employed. Even if you train somebody as a plumber, he or she cannot immediately go out in the market and open his shop, because a lot of other business skills are required and a lot of practical experience is required to give you confidence to open up your own business. In both cases, growth is a prerequisite. Skills leads to entrepreneurship, something I've already explained to you, that you know, you can't just train a motorcycle mechanic and expect him to open a workshop the next day. He or she will need to do a lot of on-job training, and experience needs to be accumulated before he or she finds confidence to start out on its own. Skills development programs, at least in the case of Pakistan, they are not currently scalable because the right trainers cannot be found. And training providers may find that the skills that they are targeting are not suitable for the target population because literacy and numeracy skills are lacking. There is a high opportunity cost. People are already working. So even if people are uneducated, they are still able to find their livelihoods, and coming to train means that they have to give up their jobs. And trainees may displace other less skilled people. So for example, if you're training people as an electrician in a training center, which is financed by the government, you are actually trying to do the work of an informal electrician who already has a chota with him, And that chota would find his or her prospects diminished if the government starts to train a big number of electricians without there being actual jobs in the market. Skills programs can be good investments, but cost benefit analysis is important. It has been pointed out by donor organizations again and again that the employment rates of training programs are extremely low. A very good training program might expect to that at the end of about 6 months after the training completes, hardly 30 to 35% are in jobs. So the employability or employment rates are extremely low. And there's also the risk of these trainings becoming obsolete. For example, those who are trained on a manual gear system might find that in 5 years' time, there are no manual gears, and therefore the skill that he or she has acquired are obsolete. The skills ecosystem, that's important. On the one hand, you have an individual who is constrained by education, by finances, by culture. On the other hand, you have trainers who are not willing to go out to villages. They are not of good quality. You have employers who need to be accessed through networks, which the poor people do not have. Then you have markets, which might be far away. And if people are interested, I think you should delve deeper into the role of markets and the proximity to market, the role that proximity plays in poverty alleviation. A case of Amul India is important. In that case, the big market of Mumbai was close by, which provided a big opportunity for milk producers in rural areas in the province, in the state. And they were able to provide or supply their milk in time to a large market. So proximity to market and the kind of condition the markets offer are important. So whenever people think or practitioners think about skills, they need to think about a skills ecosystem. Basically, here's a rundown of the different challenges and constraints in skills provision. I'll just elaborate on the last one, that skills in the case of, if you're looking at it as an economic intervention, suffers highly from market failures. And the market failure exists because the firms who are there, who are the ultimate users of skills, are not willing to pay. The trainees themselves do not have the liquidity to access trainings, and therefore the gap between the individual and the ultimate employer remains unbridged. Firms like to train their own people because they think that if they employ people trained by training service providers, you know, the skills might be general enough and they might be poached by other firms. So they try to train individuals in a narrow range of skills and try to retain them as far as possible. So a huge market failure in terms of skills development exists. By the way, if you look at the per trainee cost in vocational training sector, you'll find out that compared to education, a month of education or school costs about 800, 900 rupees. If you're looking at organizations like Sindh Education Fund or Punjab Education Fund, that's what they're paying to private schools. Maybe there are other costs, but if you look at vocational training providers, even if you look at the very basic skills like motor mechanics, the cost of training one motor mechanic is many times that of providing schooling. So it's an expensive proposition. Individuals are not able to pay, and unless and until the employers are there to chip in and government support is there in terms of stipends or other facilities, this market failure is bound to persist. A few directions to explore in Pakistan. We are insufficiently involving employers. We are not paying attention to the informal sector. We need to take the whole of market approach for informal type of skills. For example, we need to explore further the idea of cooperatives and developing skills ecosystems in themselves, where skills are there, they are employed, and a linkage to market is available and is sustained over time. We need to develop literacy and numeracy skills for our informal workers. And when it comes to the formal sector, perhaps following the sectoral approach is very, very important. Finally, the last word is that there's been very little effort in researching the area of skills program. Experiments have been undertaken. There's little understanding of what works and what doesn't, but that body of knowledge is building up. We need to invest more and need to have the patience for the results to come in due course, so that we're able to design a skills program in a better way. And we don't just assume away that vocational training and skills is there for the poor, and they would automatically take up any skills program that the government would offer in the market. So thank you very much. And if there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
Thank you, ma'am. So we are open for questions. And before that, just very quickly, I would like to also thank you for obliterating our urban bias. So far, we haven't looked at the agrarian landscape as such when it comes to economy. So this was a very needed intervention. Do I see hands? Jee Irfan, go ahead.
थैंक यू मैडम आपकी प्रेजेंटेशन का. मुझे पूछना ये था कि जैसे आपने एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर के अंदर जो स्किल्स सेट वहाँ पे रिजल्ट शो किए, तो मुझे पूछना ये था कि जो डिक्लाइन आया है, ये जो पहले हमने एसोसिएट देखा है कि प्रोडक्शन जो है वो बहुत ज़्यादा इंक्रीज की है, यहाँ पर स्किल्स दी गई और फिर अचानक से डिक्लाइन आया है, इसकी क्या वजह है? क्या कोई डाटे में इशू है या किस तरह से आप इसको एक्सप्लेन करेंगे? मुझे तो इस तरह से लग रहा है कि जैसे वो प्रोजेक्ट इंटरवेंशन को बाज़ दफ़ा जैसे होता है हमारे मतलब सेक्टर्स के अंदर के जो प्रोजेक्ट के मैनेजर्स होते हैं वो प्रोजेक्ट की सक्सेस को शो करने के लिए डाटा को बूस्ट देते हैं, तो इस तरह का कंपोनेंट तो नहीं है, इस तरह की कोई चीज़ तो नहीं है?
ये जो डिक्लाइन है ये भी उसी सेट ऑफ रिसर्चर्स ने शो किया. सो रिसर्चर्स इंडिपेंडेंट थे और रिसर्चर्स जो थे वो फंड के साथ उनका ताल्लुक भी नहीं था, एंड नाइदर वर दे गेटिंग एनी मनी फ्रॉम द रिसर्चर्स, दे वर गेटिंग मनी डायरेक्टली फ्रॉम द डोनर्स, सो कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट इस केस में नहीं था. बट उन्होंने इसको जो डिक्लाइन है उसको उन्होंने प्रिस्क्रिप्टिव मोड में देखा है, और रिपोर्ट ये कहती है कि यू नो जब से ये एग्रीकल्चरल एक्सटेंशन सिस्टम आया है तो आप देखें कि जो एग्रीकल्चरल एक्सटेंशन वर्कर भी होता है वो हर साल फील्ड में जाता है और फार्मर्स को कॉन्स्टेंटली ही इज गिविंग एग्रीकल्चर और लाइफ स्टॉक रिलेटेड नॉलेज टू देम. So it's basically the timing of the knowledge that is given to them, and given the fact that the literacy levels are low, maybe the need is there to constantly reiterate, repeat the good practices to them so that they are able to apply those practices on receiving that information. Because aapne dekha ki knowledge mein koi farak जो है वो नहीं पड़ रहा था. इन्होंने जो इंटरवेंशन और ट्रेनिंग थी वो सिंक्रोनाइज की थी विद द क्रॉप साइकिल. सो व्हाइल द वीट वाज बीइंग सोन दे वर बीइंग टोल्ड अबाउट हाउ वीट इज सोन, जमीन कैसे आपने प्रिपेयर करनी है, किस कितना आपने जो है वो कितने डिस्टेंस पे सोइंग करनी है. सो इट एक्चुअली अंडरस्कोर्स द नीड टू कॉन्स्टेंटली जो है कीप ऑन गिविंग इंफॉर्मेशन एंड नॉलेज अबाउट गुड एग्रीकल्चर एंड एग्रोनॉमिक प्रैक्टिसेस टू द फार्मर्स. आई डोंट थिंक दैट देयर इज एनी डेटा फजिंग हेयर बिकॉज बोथ द रिजल्ट्स वर रिपोर्टेड क्वाइट ऑनेस्टली. जी
मारूफ, यू कैन गो अहेड. मारूफ आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही है. सो आई थिंक वी मूव टू सहर. या मारूफ, यू नीड टू फिक्स योर माइक्रोफोन. तब तक हम सहर का सवाल सुन लेते हैं. ठीक है
जी. अस्सलाम वालेकुम मैडम, हाउ आर यू?
आई एम फाइन सहर, हाउ आर यू?
I'm good, madam. Madam, I have a question. Do you think it would be a good idea to align our technical training with some sort of an labor export policy, like something on the lines of Philippines, like they've specialized in maid services, and can we do something of that sort? Do you think that would be possible for Pakistan? Likely.
It is possible, बात ये है कि अगर आप ग्रोथ के कॉन्टेक्स्ट में देखें तो अगर आपके मुल्क में ग्रोथ नहीं होगी तो यू नो यू आर एक्चुअली प्रोवाइडिंग स्किल्स टू समवेयर सम अदर कंट्री वेयर ग्रोथ इज हैपनिंग. इट्स एग्जैक्टली द सेम केस फॉर पाकिस्तान दैट वी स्किल वी एजुकेट पीपल एंड वी स्किल वर्कर्स टू प्रमोट द ग्रोथ एंड डेवलपमेंट ऑफ सम अदर कंट्री. बट अगर आप पॉवर्टी एलिविएशन की बात कर रहे हैं तो आई थिंक द नंबर्स आर सो ह्यूज इन पाकिस्तान दैट सेंडिंग पीपल अब्रॉड इज नॉट अ वायबल ऑप्शन इन सच ग्रेट नंबर्स. वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट यू नो 60% ऑफ 205 million. सो यस, थिंग्स कुड बी डन एंड वॉट नीड्स टू बी डन इज दैट वी नीड टू सेंड better skilled people to the Middle East and to other areas where our skilled workforce is going, because currently a high proportion of them is totally unskilled jo help ke taur pe jate hain, and in the upper level skills there are very few Pakistanis in terms of percentage. So that area is being taken up more and more by the Indians, by the Philippines and by other countries. But overall, when you talk about poverty alleviation, so phir, you know, something has to be thought, and jobs have to be created, growth needs to be generated for people to find employment. ये इसका मेरा ख्याल है लुबे लुबाब ये है कि for exporting skilled worker is an option, but not in such big numbers that it can effectively address poverty in our country because of the scale of the issue.
Thank you, madam.
Ma'am, we have a question in the chat. So Maruf ka microphone kaam nahi kar raha tha, so he has posted. We discussed the supply side policy in terms of upskilling the labor, but beyond that, how do we tackle the possible lack of labor demand?
Growth, that's my answer. Labor, you know, skills will only be useful if there are jobs. And, you know, we make the mistake of saying that if we train people to be skilled enough in areas where they can open up their own businesses, you need to be aware of the fact that either it is a direct demand for skill for their labor, or there is a demand for their product. And if growth is low, both will be low. The direct demand for labor will also be low, and the demand for the product which the labor is producing, which you know you can expect somebody to be self-employed and producing that product, will also be low. So again, वही जो myth थी that skills follow jobs. Jobs actually are not created automatically. Jobs need to be there for skilled workers to be able to connect with them. I hope that answers your question.
So we will move on. Maruf's microphone is not working for him to answer that, but you have clearly answered the question. So we'll move to Javeria. जवेरिया आप पूछ लें सवाल.
थैंक यू मैम फॉर योर इंटरेस्टिंग प्रेजेंटेशन. So as we are talking about this skill development program, so my question is related to a Punjab Economic Opportunities Program. So I came across a report जिसमें यही बताया गया था कि पंजाब साउथ पंजाब के जिन फोर डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स के लिए प्रोग्राम लिया गया वहां पर भी जो एजुकेशन लिटरेसी रेट था वो इतना लो था कि लोग वहां पे बेसिक स्किल्स के लिए भी जो है एनरोल नहीं हो सकते थे. So I just want to know कि वो प्रोग्राम किस हद तक इफेक्टिव रहा और उसके थ्रू कुछ स्किल्स डेवलपमेंट हो सकती नहीं क्या. आई वांट टू नो द स्केल ऑफ दैट प्रोग्राम एंड द लेवल ऑफ इम्प्लीमेंटेशन एंड इट्स इफेक्ट ऑन द लेवल ऑफ पॉवर्टी एलिविएशन इन दोस डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स. थैंक यू.
जवेरिया जो इनिशियल रिजल्ट्स थे ऑफ स्किल्स प्रोग्राम्स इन दोस फोर डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स वो मैं आई जस्ट शेयर्ड विद यू द स्किल्स फॉर एम्प्लॉयमेंट स्किल्स फॉर मार्केट्स के भी कोई इतने अच्छे रिजल्ट्स नहीं थे. और जो एग्रीकल्चरल स्किल्स में उन्होंने शुरू किए वो अगेन यू सीन दैट इमीडिएटली आफ्टर द प्रोग्राम द रिटर्न्स वर हाई एंड दे डिप्ड क्वाइट स्टीपली आफ्टर द फर्स्ट ईयर. देर वॉज अ डिबेट विद इन द फंड के जी शुरू में भी मैं जिस तरह बता रही थी दैट देर वॉज एन इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट हु वाज सेइंग दैट यू नो स्किल्स प्रोग्राम शुड फॉलो द इंडस्ट्री. यू शुड गो टू द पार्ट्स वेयर यू नो इंडस्ट्री इज फ्लरिशिंग रादर देन टू a part of Punjab which is depressed. So unless and until something is done about the industry there or the agriculture sector there, usko revive karne ke liye agar aap jo hai wo pehle steps jab tak nahi lenge kuch subsidies ki surat mein ya other stimulus kind of programs, jobs will not be created there and it's living in a fool's paradise if you're expecting people to be trained and to find jobs in the vicinity. So, वो इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट तो शुरू से कहते रहे कि move the program and as a result, the scope of the program was enhanced and they were allowed to expand to central and northern Punjab. In terms of poverty alleviation, the results are not very encouraging, I must say. जो employment के थे उसमें भी it was realized that unless and until you have networks and people are there to connect these trained people with employment opportunities. It was going to be very, very difficult for people living in, say, Bahawalpur to know about jobs in Lahore or in Rawalpindi and go and work there. So the program had to incorporate a job search function there for people in industrial skills.
Thank you, ma'am. We'll hear from Abdul Rahman, and then we also have a question in the chats from our fellow in Balochistan, Joke. She looks at poverty elevation for women in Balochistan. So I've posted on behalf of her.
How do you see the involvement of? Ji, पहले आप पूछने जी.
Okay. So, ma'am, जैसे आपने कहा मैं भावपूर्ण बात करी मैं भावपूर्ण से हूँ. तो यहाँ पे मतलब बहुत ज़्यादा टॉक्स ये हैं कि जैसे जैसे फ्रीलांसिंग राइज कर रही है तो मतलब अब हमें फिज़िकल जॉब्स की ज़रूरत इतनी ज़्यादा नहीं है. मतलब अगर आपको कुछ एज अ स्टूडेंट मैं बात करूँ तो हम इतना अर्न कर सकते हैं लाइक पॉकेट मनी और इवन यहाँ पे लोग वो भी हैं जो दे आर अर्निंग इन सिक्स फिगर्स थ्रू फ्रीलांसिंग. तो अगर लाइक वो और स्किल्स दिए जाएँ जो जिसके लिए आपकी जॉब की ज़रूरत ना हो पर आप फ्रीलांसिंग करके अर्निंग कर सकते हैं कि लाइक भावलपुर मुल्तान ये साउथ पंजाब में आते हैं लेकिन ये उस तरह के इलाके नहीं जहाँ पे इंटरनेट की अवेलेबिलिटी ना हो. इंटरनेट अवेलेबल है तो एंड मोस्टली लोगों के पास स्मार्टफोन्स तो हैं एटलीस्ट अगर इवन लैपटॉप्स अगर कंप्यूटर्स नहीं भी स्मार्टफोन हर किसी के पास हैं. तो ऐसे स्किल्स दिए जाएँ जो फ्रीलांसिंग को कर सकें. और इसके अलावा ये बात तो लाइक पूरी दुनिया में चल रही है कि इस कॉलेज डिग्री वर्थ इट. लाइक लोग बहुत ज़्यादा पे कर रहे हैं कॉलेज डिग्री के लिए पाकिस्तान में तो फिर भी इतनी कॉस्टली नहीं है. तो इस बारे में आई वुड लाइक टू नो योर व्यू पॉइंट. थैंक यू.
अब्दुल रहमान वही बात की है जो लास्ट वाली बात आप कह रहे हैं उसमें बात ये दुरुस्त है दैट द क्वालिटी ऑफ एजुकेशन हैज गॉन डाउन एंड मोस्टली डिग्रीज आर देयर फॉर सिग्नलिंग दैट यू नो सम एबिलिटी इज देयर बट इन टर्म्स ऑफ कंटेंट इज नॉट मच एंड द क्वालिटी हैज डिक्लाइंड. तो आप मेरे से ज्यादा जानते हैं. इन टर्म्स ऑफ द फ्रीलांसिंग थिंग उसमें अगेन ये है कि आई बिलीव द डिमांड फॉर प्रोडक्ट्स और सर्विसेज इज कमिंग फ्रॉम अब्रॉड. लेकिन की चीज ये है कि जब ये प्रोग्राम डिजाइन हुआ तो द इंटेंशन वाज टू एलिविएट पॉवर्टी. एंड इफ यू लुक एट द एजुकेशनल स्टेटस ऑफ पुअर पीपल इन बहावलपुर तो द फिगर्स आर देयर. यू कैन गो टू द वेबसाइट psdf.org.pk एंड लुक एट द हाउसहोल्ड सर्वे. तो उसमें बहुत लो लेवल ऑफ एजुकेशनल अटेनमेंट मिलता है. एंड द काइंड ऑफ स्किल्स यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट require some basic education. So coding hai ya software skills hai wo obviously aise logon ke paas hai jinhone pehle matric kiya uske baad koi course kiya ya fa ya ba kiya then they did some course ya coursework nahi kiya software mein bachelor's kiya. So baat ye hai ki aap skills development ko you associate it with poverty but when it comes to Pakistan it cannot be applied readily to the case of poor and vulnerable. Aur pehle yahi behas ho rahi thi ki ji poverty ka ye this is not a suitable policy intervention to address poverty in Pakistan because you know the access barriers or the entry requirements for even the basic kinds of skills are at least matric or middle pass. So in terms of looking at skills development as a pro poverty intervention, I think some more thinking needs to be done and some different kinds of training providers need to be nurtured who are able not only to bridge the literacy gap, the numeracy gap of the poor, but also to provide vocational trainings to them.
Thank you, ma'am. Yes,
thank you very much, ma'am. Shall we move to the comment in the section?
Ji, and the comment is, how do you see the involvement of rural women in training skills project where they know that there is no financial growth, like the INGOs provide sewing machine and little amount to motivate them? Ji, the question is from Balochistan, I believe.
Yes.
Ye jo lesson hai SFM ka, skills for markets ka, jisme I think a lot of hard work went into motivating women, giving them information, setting up training centers in villages, providing them stipends, giving them skills. Or in the end, jo hai, they were not able to produce results because either you know, they were not applying those skills, they didn't have time to be full time stitchers, or that the market was not giving them enough returns. So us case mein aapne dekha ki 30,000 rupees ek training pe lag raha tha aur 2300 rupya jo hai wo saal ka unko unki income mein increase tha. So I believe that unless and until market is studied and those kinds of skills are discovered jahan pe returns jo hai wo higher hai and the investment is really producing high enough benefits to be able to cover the costs, I think you know, it would not be a feasible investment from the government's point of view, and it will not be an attractive proposition for the women as well.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, mera bhi ek sawal tha chota sa, which is ke we've been looking at it from a very agrarian point of view. Lekin ek perspective ye bhi hai ke rural landscapes evolve kar rahe hain, wo peri-urban hain ya wo semi-urban hain. To ek proactive skills development policy, are you of the opinion that it should develop skills that align more with an urban landscape too, jisme IT aa jata hai, service industry aa jati hai, kyunki eventually all these places will be agglutinated by this wave of urbanism that we see in Pakistan currently.
Ji Fatma, of course skills always have to be aligned with the economy and with the demand. Skills ka masla ye hai ki skills, providing skills is expensive and they can quickly go out of fashion as well. Hamare jo training providers hain Punjab mein, they are two big public sector training providers, DEVTA and Punjab Vocational Training Council. They are doing their best, but the way in which the urban landscape is evolving and different new kinds of requirements are coming up, I think the public sector providers have little incentive or little ability to keep pace with the new requirements. I think the need is there to bring employers in a big way and to create their interest, generate their interest in coming and taking the central place in the skills landscape. And usme jo model hai, ek to bahut tried and tested model hai, German jo model hai, jisme the employers come together and they provide apprenticeship to people. Yahan pe bhi apprenticeship law hai 1962 ka, which says ke you have to train, I think 5% of your total labor force, or unko on job training deni hai, but that law is flouted and it's not implemented. I think without bringing in employers and without establishing a direct connection with the kind of skills and jobs that are needed in the urban areas, whether it is the industrial sector or the services sector, it's the public providers will always struggle, and their trainees will not be able to find good jobs in the market.
Thank you very much for that and for your wonderful session. It was, I think, so grounded also in statistics and your practice and your experience which you brought to light. So with that said, unless anyone has a question, we will conclude our session for today.
I think I must commend all of you for sitting late and listening to me so attentively Sunday evening. So I would give a big clap to all of you.
We're very eager learners. Ms. Sara, ab hume underestimate kar rahi hai. We've been doing this for 17 days now. But it was a pleasure listening to you. We hope to keep in touch with you through Twitter and follow all the amazing work that you're doing for the services and inspiring women, especially who are civil service aspirants. Aur yahan kaafi hai waise.
Thank you very much. And good luck to all of you. I hope your remaining sessions go smoothly and are fruitful to you. Thank you. Thank you. Best of luck.